हेलो ऑल। सो लेट्स डिस्कस अबाउट नाउ द एमसीक्यू रिवीजन सीरीज ऑफ रेस्पिरेटरी सिस्टम। ओके, रेस्पिरेटरी सिस्टम। एंड इन रेस्पिरेटरी सिस्टम वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट थ्री टॉपिक्स व्हिच इज इम्पॉर्टेंट फॉर योर एंट्रेंस एग्जाम। द फर्स्ट इज ब्रोंकियल एस्थमा, द सेकेंड इज द ड्रग्स फॉर कफ, एंड सर्टन मिसलेनियस टॉपिक्स लाइक पल्मोनरी हाइपरटेंशन and analeptics. Analeptics are the drugs which stimulate respiratory centers, So these are the four topics which are important for the chapter of respiratory system. So let's start with each of the MCQ. So we will be having various MCQs related to for these four topics. So let's start with the first question. The first question is asking, the drug which is not used in acute attack of asthma is, the answer for this question is montelukast. Now remember, for acute attack of asthma we use two drugs. First we use is bronchodilator, and second we use IV hydrocortisone. Hydrocortisone is a corticosteroid which is given in acute attack of asthma. Why? Because it will reduce inflammation and it will increase the activity of bronchodilator. And among bronchodilator, we have three drugs. You will write a mnemonic, four drugs. You will write a mnemonic Batman. B for beta 2 agonist, like inhalational salbutamol. We give inhalational salbutamol. Okay. We can give subcutaneous injection of terbutaline. Terbutaline is the only beta 2 agonist which is given by subcutaneous injection, and intravenous salmeterol. So these three bronchodilators are used in acute attack of asthma. Then we give anticholinergic drugs like ipratropium. Then we use a modification of theophylline. So we give a congener of theophylline known as aminophylline. They are phosphodiesterase inhibitor. They also relax bronchial muscle. Aminophylline is given in a dose of 5 to 6 milligram per kg, and this is also the dose of hydrocortisone, that is 5 milligram per kg, or you can write 100 milligram of IV dose. Okay, and lastly we give magnesium sulfate. So this Batman mnemonic, you must remember, these are bronchodilators along with hydrocortisone is given in acute attack of asthma. Apart from this, no other drug is given in acute attack of asthma. So montelukast is not given. It's a leukotriene receptor blocker, not given in acute attack of asthma. Now the second question is asking, which of the following can be administered by subcutaneous route? We know that terbutaline is administered by subcutaneous route. It is the only beta 2 agonist given by subcutaneous injection. Which of the following is not used in the treatment of pulmonary artery hypertension? The answer for this question is alpha blockers. Now the drugs for pulmonary artery hypertension, remember, are two. You'll write Coke and Pepsi. Okay, so you'll write the mnemonic Coke and Pepsi. So for C, you will write calcium channel blockers like amlodipine, nifedipine, diltiazem. Calcium channel blockers are used. And calcium channel blockers are used if the patient is having systemic hypertension as well. It is the drug of choice in that case. Now among Pepsi, you will write, we give PGI2 analogs. Okay. We also give endothelin antagonist. Among PGI2 analog, you can write these drugs. They will have prost word in between, like triprostinil, epoprostenol, and eloprost. Okay, so the complete detail you can go to the lectures. Endothelin antagonists, they will end with the word entan. They are considered as a drug of choice, like bosentan, sitazentan, etc. Try to remember entan word. Then we have phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor like sildenafil and tadalafil. Okay. Then we have soluble guanyl cyclase activator. The drug name is rioseguat. And lastly, I stands for IPR agonist. IPR is a receptor of PGI2. The drug name is Selexipag. So it's an oral PGI2 analog. So these are the drugs, Pepsi, you must remember, are used in the treatment of pulmonary artery hypertension. So calcium channel blockers are used. Prostacyclins, which are also known as PGI2 analogs, they are also used. PGI2 is also known as prostacyclin. And endothelin antagonists, they are also used. Now the corticosteroid which is given by inhalational route in bronchial asthma is beclomethasone. Beclomethasone is an inhalational corticosteroid which is given by inhalational route. Now apart from beclomethasone, other drugs are fluticasone, which is also an inhalational corticosteroid. And you will write it is the most potent which require least dose. You can write other drugs like mometasone. Okay. You'll write flunisolide, budesonide, and ciclesonide. Now this ciclesonide, remember, is also known as soft steroid because it is an inactive drug orally. It gets activated in the lungs only. And the last drug you can write is triamcinolone. So triamcinolone is used. So these are the list of the drugs which are given in bronchial asthma of corticosteroid, which are given by inhalational route. Now what is the loading dose of aminophylline? We know that aminophylline is given in 5 to 6 mg/kg in the treatment of status asthmaticus or acute severe asthma or during the acute attack of asthma. Now which of the following anti-asthma drug is not a bronchodilator? We have already discussed that the list of the bronchodilator is Batman, that is beta-2 agonist, okay, like salbutamol, terbutaline, salmeterol, etc. Okay, so formeterol is a type of beta-2 agonist, so it is a bronchodilator. Then you will write anticholinergic drugs. So ipratropium is an example of anticholinergic drug. Then you will write theophyllines. It is also an. And lastly, magnesium sulfate. So these are the. Batman is an example of bronchodilator. So this theophylline is also a bronchodilator. So the answer for this question is sodium chromoglycate. Remember, any drug which has a chrome word in it is a mast cell stabilizer. Mast cell stabilizer. Any drug which has a chrome word in it is a mast cell stabilizer. You can write other drug is chromolin, nidocromil. So these are the examples of mast cell stabilizers. These mast cell stabilizers are given by inhalational route. And remember, they are never given in acute attack of asthma. Because in acute attack of asthma, already the mast cells have degranulated. They are only given for prophylaxis of asthma. They are only given for prevention of asthma or prophylaxis of asthma, like exercise-induced asthma, seasonal asthma, etc. So they are not bronchodilators. Now, which let's come to the seventh question. Which of the following is not an adverse effect of salbutamol? Now, the point is, if we talk about salbutamol, salbutamol is a beta-2 agonist. Now, if you talk about the side effects of beta-2 agonist, we can write a mnemonic 3T and 3H. The most common side effect of beta-2 agonist is tremors, and it is also the dose-related side effect. Because of beta-2 receptor present on skeletal muscles, it can cause tachycardia or palpitations. It can lead to tachyphylaxis. Tachyphylaxis is also known as rapid tolerance or rapid loss of effect. So beta-2 agonists, they show rapid loss of effect or tolerance, also known as tachyphylaxis. And how we can improve the sensitivity or reduce the tolerance of beta-2 agonists? Remember, we can give corticosteroid to reduce this tolerance. Corticosteroid reduce the tolerance to beta-2 agonists and restore the effectiveness. They also cause hypokalemia because the potassium which is present inside the blood, it will enter into the skeletal muscles due to beta-2 action. Hence, it will lead to hypokalemia. It leads to hyperglycemia. Why? Because beta 2 receptors are present on liver, and if you stimulate beta 2 receptor, it will lead to glycogen breakdown. And if glycogen breakdown will occur, remember, the blood glucose level will increase, hence it will lead to hyperglycemia, and they may cause transient hypoxia due to ventilation perfusion mismatch. They may cause hypoxia due to ventilation perfusion mismatch because of dilatation of bronchial in the upper airways, where the blood supply or perfusion is already very less. So these are the examples. So we know it causes tachycardia. It can cause tachyphylaxis intolerance, which is reduced by corticosteroid. It causes hypokalemia. So which effect is not caused? It is hypoglycemia. Hypoglycemia is not an adverse effect of beta 2 agonist. It is rather hyperglycemia due to glycogen breakdown. Okay? Due to glycogen breakdown. Now, which of the following receptors theophylline has antagonistic activity? The answer for this question is adenosine receptor. Now, what are the effects of theophylline? Why theophylline is used in asthma? Because theophylline is both bronchodilator, plus it also reduces inflammation. It has anti-inflammatory property. So now what are the function, what is the mechanism of action of theophylline in asthma? How does it cause bronchodilation and anti-inflammatory action? We will write one mnemonic that the main mechanism of action of theophylline is, it is a phosphodiesterase inhibitor, especially phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor. Okay, this is the main mechanism of action of bronchodilator action of theophylline, phosphodiesterase inhibition. Second, it is also adenosine antagonist. Third, you will write, it also inhibit nuclear factor kappa B. It inhibit, hence it reduces the production of inflammatory markers like interleukins. Fourth, it reduces calcium entry. It inhibit the calcium entry into the muscles. Okay, remember, it causes histone deacetylation. And lastly, it reduces the level of interleukin 5 and increases the level of interleukin 10. Okay, interleukin 5 is pro-inflammatory, which causes asthma. Interleukin 10 is anti-inflammatory, which reduces asthma. So how we can remember? We will write a mnemonic for this, that is PANCHI. Okay, PANCHI. So try to remember. This is the mnemonic of adenosine theophylline action. So it acts on adenosine receptor and it blocks adenosine receptor. It is adenosine receptor antagonist. Okay. Now the next question is, all of the following are the adverse effect seen with the use of salbutamol except. It causes tremors, we have already discussed. It causes tachycardia or palpitation, true. It causes hypokalemia, true. It causes hypotension, it is absolutely false. Okay, false. It does not cause hypotension. Okay, it sometimes rather may cause hypertension also because of cardiac stimulation. Now, all of the following drugs are useful in the bronchial asthma are bronchodilators except, which is not a bronchodilator. We have already written the mnemonic Batman. So Batman was bronchodilator. So T for theophylline, anticholinergic, ipratropium, salmeterol, beta 2 agonist. Remember, beclomethasone is not a bronchodilator. It is rather a corticosteroid. So corticosteroids, which are used in asthma, are not bronchodilators. Okay, so the answer is beclomethasone. The release of histamine and leukotriene from the mast cell is prevented by. So the question is asking about mast cell stabilizers. And we have discussed that mast cell stabilizers, they will have a word, chrome word in between. So you can find the answer as sodium chromoglycate. Okay. Now, which is the soft steroid used in bronchial asthma? The answer is cyclesonide. Now, why cyclesonide is known as soft steroid? Because it is a prodrug and it is inactive. And it becomes activated only when it reaches to the lungs with the help of certain esterases enzymes out there. Now, what is the advantage of using this cyclesonide? As we know that the cyclosonide is inactive corticosteroid, even if it gets deposited in mouth, it will not cause oral candidiasis, because one of the most common side effect of inhalational corticosteroid is oral candidiasis. Cyclosonide will not cause oral candidiasis because it is inactive drug if it is getting deposited in mouth and pharynx. Okay. Now the drug that does not result in theophylline toxicity. Now remember, theophylline, it is metabolized by CYP1A2 enzyme, and this theophylline is a narrow therapeutic index drug. That means narrow therapeutic index drug means it has a low, narrow means low, and therapeutic index is known as safety margin of a drug. So it is a narrow safety margin. Now remember, among all anti-asthma drug, it is the only unsafe drug we have, and this drug is the only anti-asthma drug that requires monitoring, and this monitoring is known as therapeutic drug monitoring. That means we monitor the blood concentration level of theophylline. The blood concentration level of theophylline must be between 5 to 15 microgram per ml, because more than 15 it will produce toxicity. Now the point is, if any drug which inhibit CYP1A2 will lead to increase in toxicity of theophylline. So if we inhibit the CYP1A2 enzyme, it will lead to toxicity, because CYP1A2 enzyme is responsible for degradation or metabolism of theophylline. So if we inhibit CYP1A2 enzyme, it will lead to toxicity. So these drugs are known as enzyme inhibitors. So enzyme inhibitors can lead to toxicity of theophylline. So we had already discussed the mnemonic of enzyme inhibitors in our video series. But related to theophylline, remember, these are the drugs which can lead to increase in toxicity of theophylline. You can write a mnemonic, okay? So the first drug is ciprofloxacin. You'll write omeprazole, cimetidine, allopurinol. And with allopurinol, you can write one antiarrhythmic drug, amiodarone. And lastly, erythromycin. So these are the drugs which can lead to theophylline toxicity. So you can clearly see amoxicillin is not given in the option, and this drug does not result in theophylline toxicity because amoxicillin is not an enzyme inhibitor. Now the next question is, to prevent exercise-induced bronchial asthma, the drug used is. Now remember, what is the management of asthma? Remember, if you talk about the management of asthma, for acute attack of asthma, remember, the drug of choice is salbutamol or any other short-acting beta-2 agonist. Okay, they are drug of choice for acute attack of asthma. But if you talk about prevention of asthma or prophylaxis of asthma, the drug of choice is any type is inhalational corticosteroid. Inhalational corticosteroid. But if inhalational corticosteroid is not given, then the second choice of drug is mast cell stabilizers. Okay, but overall the drug of choice for prevention of asthma is inhalational corticosteroid. If it is not given, then it should be mast cell stabilizers. Now if you see this question, to prevent exercise induced asthma, we are finding here sodium chromoglycate. Chrome word is coming, that means it's a mast cell stabilizer. Corticosteroid is not given, hence this is the answer for this question number 14. Now, which of the following drugs have been found to be useful in acute severe asthma? Now remember, acute severe asthma was earlier also known as status asthmaticus. And we had already discussed that in status asthmaticus, we use bronchodilators in the first question, that is Batman, and IV hydrocortisone. Okay, and among bronchodilator, we had written a mnemonic, Batman. Now, which of the following drug is not used in acute severe asthma? M for magnesium sulfate, yes, it is used. Okay, anti-leukotrienes. Okay, No, it is not used. Mast cell stabilizer not used. Cyclosporin not used. Okay, so the answer for this question is magnesium sulfate. It's a bronchodilator. Now, which of the following is a bronchodilator? We know salmeterol. Salmeterol is a bronchodilator. It's a beta 2 agonist. It's a long acting beta 2 agonist. Okay. Which of the following drug is not useful? Not useful in acute attack of asthma. Again, try to find cromolyn because it's a mast cell stabilizer. It is given in prevention of asthma. While beta 2 agonist salbutamol is used, theophylline is also used, hydrocortisone is also used. Now, theophylline overdose can cause. Now, if you'll talk about the toxic effects of theophylline, if you talk about the toxic effect of theophylline, we can write the toxicity of theophylline includes. What are the various toxicity of theophylline? First, you will write it may cause seizures. Theophylline, it may cause seizure. How you can remember? Theophylline is present in tea and coffee. If you consume very large amount of tea and coffee, it can lead to various side effects. Okay. Now the point is, it can cause seizures. It can produce cardiotoxicity. It can produce cardiotoxicity. It can produce diuresis. It can produce diuresis. It can lead to nausea and vomiting, which is also known as GIT disturbance, GIT upset, which is also known as GIT upset. Okay. So these are the various side effects of theophylline like drug. Now remember, seizures, diuresis and cardiotoxicity, it occurs due to phosphodiesterase inhibition. Nausea, vomiting and GIT upset, it may occur due to, it occurs due to adenosine antagonist. While nausea, vomiting and GIT upset, it occurs due to phosphodiesterase inhibition, which was their main mechanism of action. Okay. Now, keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about the answer is scissors out here. Okay, scissors. So, tea and coffee, remember, it will not cause drowsiness. It will rather cause alertness. They are not bronchospasm. They are rather used as a bronchodilator. Now, when we drink a large amount of tea and coffee, it will rather cause tachycardia, not bradycardia. So, think about high amount of tea and coffee will produce theophylline toxicity. Now, disodium chromoglycate. Chromoglycate is a mast cell stabilizer. And remember, all mast cell stabilizers are given by inhalational route. Okay. Now, all of the following statements about theophyllines are correct except. An increase in dose is required, is required in cardiopulmonary diseases. So, which of the following statement we have to find is false. Okay. So, let's talk about question 20. So, increase in dose is required in cardiopulmonary disease. The answer is absolutely false. It will rather require lesser dose. Okay. Because in cardiopulmonary disease, the metabolic activity of the body reduces. The drugs get easily accumulated out in the body. It increases cyclic AMP. The answer is absolutely true. Why it increases cyclic AMP? Because it inhibits phosphodiesterase enzyme. The function of phosphodiesterase enzyme is to degrade cyclic AMP. Increase in dose required in smoker. The answer is absolutely true because smoking is an enzyme inducer. It's an enzyme inducer. It will increase the degradation of theophylline. Hence, smokers, they require higher dose. And it inhibits phosphodiesterase enzyme. The answer is absolutely true. The incorrect statement is A. That increases dose required in cardiopulmonary disease. No, it is rather lesser doses required. Now let's talk about Zafir-Lucas. Remember, any drug which ends with the word Lucas is a leukotriene receptor blocker. So other drugs are, you'll write Montelukast, Zafir-Lucas and Pran-Lucas. So they block leukotriene 1 receptor. Now these drugs are given orally And these drugs are only given for prophylaxis of asthma. They are not useful in acute attack. And what is their main side effect? Their main side effect is Churg-Strauss syndrome. Okay? And remember, they are not given in acute attack because they are not bronchodilators. Okay? Now, why they are given in prophylaxis of asthma? The reason is they increase the effectiveness of beta-2 agonists when they are added to them. And they increase the effectiveness of corticosteroid. They help corticosteroid in their action. So they are just add-on drug in prophylaxis of asthma into long-acting beta-2 agonist and corticosteroid. They are not given in acute attack of asthma. So let's talk about the true statement now. Okay, true statement. So Zafirlukast, it is a lipoxygenase inhibitor. The answer is absolutely false. The drug which is a lipoxygenase inhibitor is rather a drug known as Zilutone. Zilutone is a lipoxygenase inhibitor, not Zafirlukast. It decreases the frequency of asthma attack as compared to glucocorticoid. The answer is absolutely false. Remember, the most effective drug in prevention of asthma is always glucocorticoid because they are the best drug we have. It blocks leukotriene receptor. The answer is absolutely true. It is effective in acute attack of asthma. The answer is false. And it can be given orally. The answer is absolutely true. So the answer is C and E. So the answer is C and E. Okay. So remember this path. Now, inflammation in the airway can be reduced by. So we have to find an anti-inflammatory. We know that the glucocorticoids are the best anti-inflammatory drug. And we have already written fluticasone and budesonide as glucocorticoid, which are given inhalationally in asthma patient. Okay, so the answer is B and D. Now, which of the following is a bronchodilator? Bronchodilator, try to remember the mnemonic Batman. Beta-2 agonist like salmeterol is a bronchodilator. Which of the following increase in level, drug which increase the level of theophylline? We know the drug enzyme inhibitor increase the level of theophylline. And we had already written the mnemonic COCA, ciprofloxacin, omeprazole, cimetidine, allopurinol, erythromycin, etc. So the answer for this question is cimetidine, allopurinol and ciprofloxacin. They will increase the level of theophylline. Why? Because they are enzyme inhibitor. But what about barbiturate? Barbiturate reduces the level. Phenytoin will reduce the level of theophylline. Why? Because these drugs are enzyme inducers. They increase the degradation of CYP enzyme by CYP enzyme of theophylline. So the toxicity or the level will be increased by B, C and D. The answer is B, C and D. Now disodium chromoglycate, again it's a mast cell stabilizer, and mast cell stabilizers are given by inhalational route. Now, what is omalizumab? Omalizumab is a monoclonal antibody that blocks IgE receptor. It blocks IgE. Because IgE is present on the surface of mast cell. And when antigen comes and binds to this IgE, this mast cell releases, becomes degranulated, and it they lead to inflammation. So what omalizumab will do, this omalizumab will block this IgE antibody. So it will block it and it will prevent the interaction of antigen and IgE monoclonal antibody. Now remember, any drug which ends with the word mab is a monoclonal antibody, and all monoclonal antibody, remember, they are given by injections. Why? Because they are water soluble, they cannot be given orally, they cannot be given inhalationally. So they are given by injection, and almost all the monoclonal antibodies, most of the monoclonal antibodies are given by subcutaneous injection. So the answer is it is given by subcutaneous injection, and omalizumab injection is given every 2 to 4 weeks interval. And where it is used, it is given in corticosteroid resistant asthma. When the corticosteroids are unable to act, we use them. It has also been approved for the treatment of Churg-Strauss syndrome. And it has also been approved for chronic urticaria. So these are the three uses of omalizumab: corticosteroid-resistant asthma, Churg-Strauss, and chronic urticaria. Okay, omalizumab. Now, the next question, 27th, is asking, efficacy of salmeterol is increased by which of the following? We had already discussed that corticosteroid reduce the tolerance of beta 2 agonist. So the effect of salmeterol, which is a beta 2 agonist, is increased if it is given by corticosteroid. Remember, that is why for prophylaxis of persistent asthma or chronic asthma, we give inhalational corticosteroid with long acting beta 2 agonist like salmeterol, because corticosteroid, they also improve the efficacy or the sensitivity of beta 2 agonist, so they reduce tolerance. Now the mechanism of action of theophylline in bronchial asthma includes all of the following except, so try to remember the mnemonic I told you, punchy, that is phosphodiesterase inhibition, mainly for adenosine antagonist. Nuclear factor kappa B will reduce. It will inhibit calcium influx, entry into muscle, histone deacetylation, and interleukin 5 will decrease and interleukin 10 will increase. So the answer for this question is adenosine antagonist. Okay. It also causes histone deacetylation. It also causes phosphodiesterase inhibition. So these are the examples except. So the except is beta 2 agonist. It has no action on beta 2 receptor. So this is the only exception in theophylline mechanism of action. Now what is dextromethorphan? Remember, dextromethorphan is used in cough. And in cough, it is an antitussive drug. Now antitussive drug means the drugs which will go and depress or inhibit cough centers in our brain. So it will go to the brain and it will directly inhibit the cough centers, hence the person will stop coughing. So the answer is antitussive. Okay, now this dextromethorphan, what is the mechanism of action? Remember, this dextromethorphan is NMDA antagonist. It blocks NMDA receptors in our brain, and remember, it has one great advantage. We have one more classes of antitussive drug, that is opioids like morphine, codeine, etc. The problem with morphine, codeine, they are also antitussive, is that these morphine are highly addictive substance, they are highly sedative substance, and they cause constipation. So opioids are also antitussives. The advantage of dextromethorphan is it is not having any of this side effect. That means dextromethorphan does not lead to, it does not cause addiction, it does not cause sedation, it does not cause constipation. So it is rather a different drug, not an opioid. So the answer is antitussive. Now, which of the following drug has no role in acute attack of asthma? We had already discussed mast cell stabilizers. Okay. Mast cell stabilizers. Okay. Okay. Now, the next question is, which of the following is not true about noscapine? Now, noscapine is also an antitussive drug. Noscapine is also an antitussive drug. And it rather act on sigma receptors, and it has similar property to dextromethorphan. We had just discussed dextromethorphan, so it is similar to dextromethorphan. That means it is non-addictive, non-constipative, and no sedative. Now let's talk about this false statement, not true about noscapine. Okay, so if you talk about noscapine, the first statement says it's an opioid alkaloid. The answer is absolutely true. But remember, it is a non-addictive opioid that we will discuss in CNS chapter. It should be avoided in asthmatic patient. The answer is absolutely true, because noscapine can provoke bronchoconstriction. Why? Because it can release histamine from mast cell. ओके नाउ इट हैज नार्कोटिक्स एनल्जेसिक एंड डिपेंडेंस प्रॉपर्टी द आंसर इज एब्सोल्युटली फॉल्स इट इज ऑब्टेन फ्रॉम सेम प्लांट फ्रॉम विच वेयर वी ऑब्टेन मॉर्फिन बट रिमेंबर नॉस्कैपीन इज अ नॉन एडिक्टिव ओपियोइड Headache and nausea are the occasional side effect. Yes, it's a very non-specific statement. The answer is absolutely true. And the answer is this one, C. Now, efficacy of inhaled corticosteroid is maximum when the particle size is. Now, remember, in bronchial asthma, the particle size of a drug should be 1 to 5 microns or 1 to 5 micrometer. Because in this size, remember, the drug when inhaled will reach to the terminal bronchiole, 1 to 5 microns. But remember, if the size is less than 1, it can go to the alveoli and it can absorb into the blood. We don't want this effect. And if the size is more than 5, remember, the drug will not reach terminal bronchiole. It will be deposited in upper airways. Hence, the size of the drug should be 1 to 5 microns. Now, therapeutic blood range of theophylline in microgram per milliliter that we had already discussed was 5 to 15 microgram per milliliter. So that was the therapeutic range we had already discussed. Which of the following is not a mucolytic? Now, mucolytic drugs, remember, they are used in cough. Which type of cough? They are given in productive cough. Productive cough means in which there is lot of sputum. Okay, we had just discussed antitussive drug. Antitussive drugs, they are given in dry cough. Okay. Antitussives, they are given in dry cough. Now, what are the examples of mucolytic? Bromhexine, N-acetylcysteine and ambroxol, they are mucolytic. Ethyl morphine is not a mucolytic. No, it is rather an antitussive. Antitussive means it will cuffs directly go to the brain and suppress the cuff centers. Okay. So, it is rather an antitussive. Which of the following statements about dextromethorphan is false or not true? It is centrally acting antitussive. We have already discussed. Yes, it acts on NMDA receptor. True. It causes constipation. No. Opioids causes constipation. It does not depress mucociliary function. True. Mucociliary function is depressed by mucolytic drugs. Okay. So remember. Okay. So. Answer is, it does not cause constipation. Opioids, they cause constipation. Which of the following is not a centrally acting antitussive? Now, the answer is dextromethorphan. True, it is a centrally acting. Noscapine is also a centrally acting antitussive drug. Okay. It is also a centrally acting antitussive drug. Now, the third option is saying that S-acetylcysteine. Now, this is false. Because N-acetylcysteine is rather a mucolytic drug. It is not an antitussive drug. It is rather a mucolytic drug. Okay. So, this is the false. This is a new drug. Remember, true. Okay. Now, leukotriene receptor antagonist for bronchial asthma. Remember, leukotriene receptor antagonist, they will end with the word leucast. So, the answer for this question is zafirleucast. Which enzyme is inhibited by aminophylline? Remember, aminophylline is a modification of theophylline. And we know that theophylline, their main mechanism of action in bronchial asthma is they are phosphodiesterase inhibitors. Now, which of the following statement about theophylline is not true or false? It inhibits antagonize adenosine receptor. It's absolutely true. We had discussed. It inhibits phosphodiesterase enzyme. Yes. It acts by decreasing cyclic AMP, it is false. Remember, inhibition of phosphodiesterase enzyme, it rather increases cyclic AMP, not reduces. Dose adjustment is required in smoker, true. Remember, they require higher dose in smokers. So, the incorrect statement is C, it rather increases cyclic AMP. The longest acting beta 2 agonist among them is salmeterol. But remember, overall longest acting, even more than salmeterol, is indactyrol. It is ultra long acting drug. It is given once a day OD. Formoterol is given BD, twice a day. Okay. So indactyrol is even longer acting than salmeterol. So remember, metro word is coming. Like metro, it will keep on running. Hence, it is a long acting beta 2 agonist. Now, complications of aerosol steroids. So, when a person inhales a corticosteroid orally, if this corticosteroid will get deposited in mouth, can we say the immunity of a person will reduce? And if the immunity of the person will reduce, it can lead to local growth of candida fungus. It can lead to oral candidiasis. Okay. So, complication of aerosol steroid is it can lead to oral candidiasis. It is also known as oral thrush. Okay. Now, mechanism of action of montelukast. Lukast word is coming. Hence, it is a leukotriene receptor antagonist. Now, all of the following statement about ketotifen is. Now, remember, ketotifen is, remember, a dual mast cell stabilizer as well as it is a antihistaminic drug. That means it blocks histamine H1 receptor. Okay. Now, because of this reason, it can be given in various allergic condition. Okay. So, let's talk about the false statement. All are true except it's a mast cell stabilizer. It's absolutely true. It has antihistaminic action. True. It is given in allergic disease. Atopic dermatitis is an allergic disease. True. So, there is no false statement in this question. Now, Churg-Strauss syndrome, remember Churg-Strauss syndrome, I told you, is a specific side effect of leukotriene receptor blocker. And leukotriene receptor blocker, they end with the word leukast and the answer is montelukast. We had already discussed. Terbutaline is a beta-2 agonist and it is the only beta-2 agonist which can be given by subcutaneous injection. So, the only beta-2 agonist given by subcutaneous injection is terbutaline. The most prominent and dose-related side effect of beta-2 agonist was, we had already discussed, that is muscle tremors. The muscle tremors is the most common and dose-related side effect of salbutamol or beta-2 agonist because of beta-2 receptor present on skeletal muscle. So, they will directly stimulate and muscle tremors will occur. Which of the following is given by intranasal application? Now, we know that sodium chromoglycate is a mast cell stabilizer. And mast cell stabilizers are given by inhalational route. Okay. So, the answer is sodium chromoglycate. Okay. Now, which of the following cannot be administered by inhalational route? So, which corticosteroid is not given by inhalational route? Remember, the corticosteroid which are not given by inhalational route are betamethasone, dexamethasone, prednisolone and hydrocortisone. So, this is the complete list of the drugs which are not given by inhalational route. Rest A, C and D are given by inhalational route. Okay. Now, which of the following is least likely to get altered the plasma level of theophylline? So, the best answer is azithromycin because azithromycin is neither an enzyme inducer nor an enzyme inhibitor. So, for the list of enzyme inducers and inhibitor, please go towards, just go to the lectures of General Pharma, Pharmacokinetics. So, erythromycin is an enzyme inhibitor. It will alter. Ciprofloxacin and chloramphenicol are also enzyme inhibitors. So, this is all about the respiratory chapter. So, thank you very much. So, keep learning. Okay, so if you have any queries, you can post into the Facebook group, Dr. Ankit Pharmacology Series. So where the link will be posted, you can comment your queries out there only. So we will try to respond. Thank you very much.